The views, comments, and opinions of the following program do not necessarily reflect those of Morris Media Studios, MorrisMediaLive.com, or its affiliates. Listener discretion is advised.
But you were meant for to give up easy. You were in a race to just lie down.
Have to address this because I was one of you. If you are off tomorrow and Sunday, you can go home, have your glass of champagne, get your bubble bath, and relax. If you don't want to relax, watch the Democratic debates. If you got it recorded, go back and watch it because you need to be up on that. Most importantly, I would be really trying to watch the impeachment hearings. That was something to see. I think that was the best show of the year. I'm going to mark that 2019's best show of the year. First, I want to do a shout out to Morris Media. Portis, thank you so much for giving me a platform. Sheena, my producer, I always call her that because what do you call someone that produces all the wonderful things that you talk about and share with your audience? But someone like her, she's my producer, and what would I do without her? I want you to call in for me at 323-293-3375. If you are on Facebook with me and you're watching me, I love you for it. But I'd rather that you tune in to YouTube and watch it live. Hit the notification button and subscribe. That's at Morris Media, www.morrismedialive.com. So I would rather you go there and watch it and enjoy it. I am on live and I am not drunk yet. So that's a positive. Let me quit saying that because I don't want people thinking I really drink. But during this term of Donald Trump, I said the name, I need a drink. Damn it. I had to wash that off my mouth. Yeah, I can't believe I said it. But during that time, I did kind of pick the bottle up a little bit too much. I got tired of crying. Then I decided I'd pick myself up and I'd try to fight with the rest of us and try to make a difference. Guys, I had a wonderful time. Let me tell you what I did. I was out Wednesday night and I was at UCLA. No, I wasn't trying to steal a degree. I was out there hanging out with Southern Poverty Law Center and I had an amazing time. But the thing about being there and enjoying the event, I had the pleasure of going. It's the things that I learned. And when I walked in, the music was playing. And they were playing the old spirituals that I grew up on because I'm from a small town called Madison, Arkansas. If you blink, you'll miss it. Population 750. And look where I'm sitting now. But my point is, I was listening and it gave me a soul stirring, as my grandmother used to say. But the thing that hit me, they were singing and the words were saying, ain't gonna let nobody turn me around. I'm gonna keep on marching, keep on fighting. And I got happy
And I got angry. I got angry for the reason that, is this my camera? Is this where I'm at? Now, if I just want to make sure where my camera is, because I want the people to really see me. I want to make sure that you understand something. If you have not registered to vote, if you have never registered to vote, if you have not voted, get up, get your ass up and go and register to vote. If you are registered and you have not placed a vote, vote. I used to sit back and hear people say, well, it's not going to make a difference. I'm not going to do it. You're not going to talk me into it. I don't care. I'm at my fill with that bullshit now. That has nothing to do with Donald Trump. I'm tired of us blaming every damn thing on this man. The only thing he is doing really is opening our eyes, because we had blinders on. We thought we had it good. We thought everything was great. All he did was open our eyes. You have got to get your ass out and vote. Somebody died for you to have that right. And when I was sitting there, I was thinking to myself, and I think I went on Facebook for a moment, and I said, why or how can you not vote? If they were killing you or making it that hard for you to vote when you don't want me to do something, then damn it, I want to know why you don't want me to do it. And if that's something you're trying to tell me I can't do, and it's not something harmful to my life other than you are threatening my life, then I know it's something that's damn me important, and I need to make sure that I'm out there doing it and being a part of it. And so my thing about it with Southern Poverty Law Center is the second thing I want us to start doing, if you're not doing it, write a check. Make some donations. Find something that you care about and donate to that organization, especially something like Southern Poverty Law Center. And sitting there, I found out, remember we were celebrating that Florida, if you had been convicted of a felon or a crime or went to prison, you had the right to vote. They passed that law, remember? Well, come to find out, when they passed the law, another law was passed. And with that law was that if you had fines and you were on a probation and all these other issues, you still could not vote. So really, we were celebrating in a false sense, because they came right back and found another way to prevent this from happening. And what Southern Poverty Law Center is doing right now is fighting. They have two young women that are standing up that were had prior convictions, served their time, and they're fighting for that right to vote, because it's against the law what they are doing. But this is not something we have not seen before and that we've not dealt with before. It's the same old song, just a different dance, you know? So you just got to understand, change your step a little bit, you know what I mean? And see, put your glasses on. Put your glasses on and quit walking around, you know, blinded by everything and just caught up in self. Get past I. If you get past I, we can really see what's really going on and what they're doing to us. And not for us as a people. The other thing I learned when I was there is I always talk about, you know, the way that we've been treated by law enforcement and things like this. And I think people tend to think when you talk about this stuff and you make it a black white issue that you're saying that you can't trust the white man or die. That's not what I was meaning. When I say something, I now understand what my grandmother said. My mom had six kids when we all were lined up and she was talking, and one of us had did something wrong. And I think she kind of already knew which one. And when I would always get ready to speak, because I didn't like getting my butt spanked, so I almost beat. And she started saying, if you wear a size 5, don't try to force on a size 2. So that meant if the shoe don't fit, don't try to wear it. And the difference is we're talking about white supremacy and the acts that are happening and what is going on. And I learned that since Trump was elected in 2016, and this is baffling for me, since he was elected in 2016, there's been a 50% increase in racial, you know what I mean, crime. I'm at a loss for words. A 50% increase? And this is the leader of our country? And we having problems about whether he should be impeached or not? You know, we still, you know, he's still, I mean, damn it, Tricky Dick, I not take Tricky Dick back any day. If y'all don't know who Tricky Dick is, do your history. I'm talking about Nixon. Because he still had compassion. You know what I'm saying? He had a care for the people. So I'm just trying to understand. That's all I'm trying to do. I'm going to show you a couple of photos where I was hanging out with my friends. My guest, Denise Harris, that comes up with me and we talk politics, called me and said, hey, they're having an event at UCLA with Southern Poverty. I want you to be there. I said, hey, I'm there. And I thank her from the bottom of my heart because I truly enjoyed the knowledge. I enjoyed being fed. I was fed so much. I think I'll be full for a lifetime of the things that they were teaching and that I thought I knew because I served with the job that I had. I worked for Southern Poverty Law Center. I was a manager of one of the campaign, and I was already learning. And being from the South, I was familiar with it and how Morris D started. But knowing what is going on now, it has changed my mentality too, because the things that they are fighting for now, in 2019, and then that this was caused by a flame started by one man. And to think years ago, the government was afraid of Malcolm X. Remember, he did the little sign. He pointed the finger. The people stood up. When he turned in that direction, they turned in that direction. When he made the signal, they walked. And they said, that's too much power for one black man. Well, I'm going to throw it back in y'all face. That's too much power for one dumbass white man. I'm going to put it back in your face and see what you think. Because he's got too much power right now. And he is dumb. Malcolm was brilliant. So, look, let's see the pictures of where we were. I did hit a couple of photos. I was out there. I enjoyed it. I can't say enough how much I enjoyed being there and being a part of it. And there was some of the crew I worked with. And Denise there in the middle with the black on is responsible with the dress for making sure that I was there present and enjoying that. Again, guys, let's start making donations. Let's start caring about something other than ourselves and what kind of shoes we have, you know, because at the end of the day, oh, that's not going to matter if we don't get this right. We got the right one now. He might push that button. So y'all better get your eyes open and pay attention. You know, you guys, I do a thing called history where I go back and tell you what was going on during the time on the date that I'm doing my show, what happened years ago. And today is November 22nd. So in history, I'm in 2019. But in 1930, Elijah Muhammad, he formed the Nation of Islam in Detroit. So they were formed in 1930. And he did that in Detroit. And henceforth, they're still here strong. I wonder when he did this in 1930, and I try to find the human things. Did he realize how many black brothers he was going to get in prison alone? You know what I mean? Because every brother that goes to prison, when they come out, LaRon, they say, Assalamu alaikum. You know what I mean? And I'm not down there. I am truly not down there, because if it'll keep you out here, you know what I mean? Doing right, my brother. Assalamu alaikum. You know what I mean? What's the other part they say? Malaikum salam. You know what I mean? See, I'm serious. If that is what it takes, because sometimes you have to replace something with something. And if he's giving them something to fill their souls, which is helping them, you know, outsource and use their mind in a different way, in a positive way, I'm for it. I'm for it. Get out there. I bought many bean pies and don't even eat them. You know? So I'm being real. The only problem I ever had with the Nation of Islam, I go there, I kind of felt a little funny about Malcolm. I kind of thought they had something to do with it. But, you know, I have my own. Y'all don't want to get me on that conspiracy. Let me take a drink. Y'all don't want to get me on that conspiracy theory thing, you know. Because I kind of got a little upset then. You know what I mean? Thinking they kind of played a role with Malcolm. Because I remember Malcolm used to say they would hire us to kill. You know what I mean? To kill us. You see what I'm saying? Then we blame for it, and then you feel like you have somebody, and you forget about it. That's the Nipsey. That's the way I feel about Nipsey. Yeah, that's what I feel about Nipsey. They will hire us to kill us, and then blame us and frame us. You understand what I'm saying? And we serve that time, and we as black people just want to feel vindicated. We don't ask questions. When Martin was murdered, you wanted to know who did it. You didn't care about the who, the what. You know, if there was this conspiracy or something went on behind, we just want to see. So they gave you one man. You want to tell me one man was able to take, you get what I mean? Take somebody like Martin Luther King down. One man. Kennedy. One man. Nah. Nah, 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 nah. But some fall for it. I never did, never have, never will. But that was my only problem with that one. In 1950, the lowest NBA score was Fort Wayne Pistons, 19. Minneapolis Lakers, 18. There must have been some damn good players. And that damn defense. I'm going to tell you right now, LeBron, that was the defense that night. They played some damn good defense. It wasn't offense because you got the points. So they defense must have been hell of a. I probably would have been like, fuck it, and just walked off the court. You know what I mean? The defense had to be on. If that's all you got to give it up for the defense. I ain't seen that kind of, you know what? I don't even see that kind of damn defense now. They too pretty to get low. They paying them all that damn money, and they too pretty to get low. It's the truth. You don't see the defense that you used to see. I played basketball, and I'm talking about we had to play defense. If you didn't know how to play defense, they give a damn about if you could score. I'm serious. You had to play. That's the first thing they talk. Because I remember scooting around on that floor, little hands. What the hell is this for? I just want to shoot the ball, coach. And I'm trying to know. You got to know how to play defense. You get what I'm saying? LeBron. If you get them boys to play some defense, boy, y'all might get something. I don't know what. Yes. Because defense is the problem, man. Because I haven't. Have you watched a game where the score was this low? I'm not defense. I defense. I'm going to say right now. In 1954, the Humane Society was formed in Washington, D.C. Now, in 1957, Miles Davis Quintet debuted the jazz concert at the Carnegie Hall in New York. Love me some Miles Davis, man. I really do. 1963, John Kennedy was assassinated by Lee Harvey Oswald. While riding, we were just talking about. I couldn't even make that up. I was just talking about that. John must think I'm doing something good right now. But I'm not laughing about it. I'm saying he must really. That kind of took a chill over. I had to laugh to keep from getting a little spooked out. Because I really was just talking about, you know, the assassination of Kennedy. I didn't even look down on this. And this was on this day. Wow. That's amazing. That's amazing in itself. Whoa. That's deep, brothers and sisters. That's deep. And then immediately after him being assassinated, now keep in mind he was assassinated while riding in an open top motorcade in Dallas. I'm not gonna lie to you, LeBron. When Obama was got out that car, him and Michelle, and they were walking, sister was praying hard. I was praying hard. You know, I was like, oh, please. Please. And then they kept walking. I'm like, get in the damn car. So I kind of think Michelle was walking with him. You know, because back then, you know, Michelle at the beginning, she wasn't really, really down. You could tell she wasn't really down for, you know, you could tell she wasn't really ready to be in the public eye like that. Honestly, I could sense that about Michelle Obama. And this is before I read about how hard it was for her. I could sense it. Women sense things. We know each other. And she's walking and I look in this a certain way, and I bet she was walking like, what the hell is this nigga got me into now? You know what I mean? Honestly. You know, because I know she, you know, you can only imagine what she went through those 8 years. Not saying he didn't go through hell, but her just every day, you know, worried and hoping and making sure that he made it safely because none but God. Because I know when he got out to walk, I was worried. I was worried for a minute, LeBron. LeBron, I was scared. I'm not going to lie. And then they swore at Lyndon B. Johnson as the 36th U.S. president after Kennedy's death. In 1965, his second title, defense, Muhammad Ali, he was the world's greatest, scored a 12-round knockout against Floyd Patterson in Las Vegas. Float like a butterfly, sting like a bee. Muhammad was bad, but I also loved his stand on the war and his stand against
everything that was going on. He let it be known he didn't have any problem with the people in Vietnam. They hadn't done anything to him. You know what I mean? And then did you see how they did him though? You know, we forget about that with Muhammad Ali. He didn't fight for a while. You know what I mean? They wouldn't let him fight. It was horrible, but 45, nothing happened to him, did it? He didn't want to serve. He didn't do anything in the army, let it be known, you know. And when we were damned if we do it damned. You know what I mean? We were just damned, wasn't we? We were just damned. And it didn't matter how much power or what we have. You get what I'm saying? Power means nothing, because if Barack Obama did one of the 300 things Donald Trump has done, we would be like, why is he out there hanging on the White House lawn? Take him down! It's the truth. If he had just did half of one of the things, of the probably 300 and some things that 45 has done. that complexion for the protection is a mother, ain't it? Okay, that stuff is something else. I'm just liking what's my boy's name, Mooney. He said, when I see somebody with white skin and they begging for money and ain't got nothing, I'm crying for them. What a waste of skin. You ain't even using what the hell you got. You got the complexion for the goddamn protection and you can't even use it. I've seen it on my own cell phone jobs. I've seen them walk in and we all have to sit four blocks off. They smell so bad. And they will let them work there that whole 2 weeks to make a check and keep working till they can build themselves up. Let one of us walk in there like that looking for a job. Security! Security! Can you get his ass out of here? We just keeping it real, guys. I'm just saying. We just keeping it real tonight. Also, guys, as I was talking about, I have a winner. I'm going to announce the winner of the book. We had the book, A Song for You. On the show last week, I had a guest, and we were talking about Robin Crawford and the new book. And I was letting it be known that whoever reached out and inboxed me and let me know I was trying to get to 200, I would give the book out. But I had a young lady. I didn't get that far. But what impressed me was she reached out more than once, more than twice. And she also let me know she kept trying to call and had tried to call in. And Lauren, I think I let her know that the show was wrapping up. So I'm going to make sure that I announce that winner and let her know that the book is already headed to her in her direction. She should be getting it any day now. Thanksgiving next week. Yeah, next week. I don't know if I'm a cook, Lauren. I don't know if I'm going to be burning in the kitchen. I don't know. But someone asked me what my favorite memory of my past family gatherings were. And I think everybody has that memory of when the wrong person show up. You know what I mean? When the wrong person show up. Now, if you're out there, you're probably getting a little nervous because it could go either way. It could be like where the ex show up because the family member invited him and you didn't want him there. And you done brought the new boyfriend or the new girlfriend. So this is going to be awkward here. See, so that could have been the one. But you know me, I'm so crazy. It's the one where mom done told you. You done told all the other relatives, don't you tell Uncle Elroy to come. We not having Thanksgiving. You get what I mean? You do not invite him, whatever you do. And I'm giving him a mock name because my family will call me and say, I know ain't no way in hell you tell that and expose that. Because you know he done been drinking before he arrived. He gonna drink on the premises. And from there, everybody that had a family secret, because he grew up with them, he gonna tell everything. And as young kids, you know, I was a teenager, but even the younger kids, you couldn't say nothing. Kids are different from the way we were. You couldn't say shit. You just look like, you could, all you had to do, you just had that look on your face. And stuff was told that you just shouldn't have even knew, you know. And you couldn't say, did that happen, Mom? You were going to get the hell slapped out of you. And you could not discuss it after the fact. You know what I mean? So though, my fondest memories is always when that person showed up. I was pretty much waiting on him. You know, I was the one sitting like near the door like, I sure hope he coming this time. You know, to be truthful, I think one or two of the times I was the one that saw him at the store, saw him somewhere else, and said, yeah, they cooking, they gonna have a big gathering. Come on by. Make my day. Seriously. But if I were to say what I am most thankful for is the freedom of choice. The freedom of choice. And that means the right to choose to be who I am, live my truth, and make my own decisions of the way I want and choose to live my life. But also that I think more and more people, human beings, are learning that they have that freedom. The freedom to choose. Just like you have the freedom to choose right from wrong. Each day we make that choice every day, and it's a hard choice. But freedom of choice is what I'm most thankful for. Not how many friends, just the fact that God has made me a able human being that has the freedom to choose things. And through him, these things are being made possible. Freedom to choose. People always say, what are you thankful? I'm thankful for God. I was thankful for God from day one, always from the beginning, in the middle, and the end. I don't even have to say it. It's just showing my faith and the smile that I show when I meet people. You know what I mean? In the work and the walk that I do, I'm always a child of God. Don't let the look fool you. He don't make mistakes. Contrary to what anybody might try to tell you, unless you want to say he's not perfect. So basically that. Now, the Black Friday thing, I'm over it. You know how they had the Black Friday shopping and all of that the day after? Too much damn money. And then the fighting. But I was a fool like that, though. I really was a fool for that stuff, Lauren. I really was about that. You know what I mean? Go stand in that line. And I'm telling you again, that when I was raising my children, I was in the South. So it was cold. So we standing there shaking. They didn't have no heated tents or nothing. You out there shaking. You there, you know what I mean? You right early. Right there dark, waiting. And then when I look back over it, I'm like, why didn't I, you know what I mean? Why didn't I, instead of waiting to get that video game, why wasn't I somewhere putting some money in some mutual funds? You know what I'm saying? Why wasn't I? It's the foolishness that we buy into this thing when it comes to the holidays, especially Christmas. And if you're a mom, you know, a parent or whatever, grandparent, we buy into it. We all do it. It's just when you get old and you look back on it. And I remember 2 days after Christmas, after I've spent maybe $2,800 or more, stuff just tossed in the corner. You know, and then they coming to you a week later. Mama, you know they got this new game. Well, so damn it, didn't I just, you better go get that shit out. You know, yeah, you better get that shit and go sit your ass down. And it's just saying, but you know what I've noticed, though? And maybe it's me, but I've noticed it's not as packed as it used to be with the Black Friday. I don't know if being able to order online, you know what I mean, has something to do with it. Because it used to really be, because when I first moved here, see, because it wasn't like that. I told you I was from a small town. And even when I moved to Little Rock, it still wasn't like here. Here was like the border. You know, people lining up. Here, you were like, what the hell? I had never seen anything like it. I was like, and then when I look at the very first person in line, I look like that motherfucker there had to be here since about 2 days ago. You know, people walking in the store was, you know, open just regular, and they like, what you doing? I'm just waiting. You know what I mean? Waiting for 2 days from now. I'm waiting for Black Friday. I'm just in there waiting. Don't worry, y'all go, don't mind me. Because you're like, what the hell? But it's not like that now. Then the holidays now, as we get older, we can't eat like we want to. If I eat something, I'm going to put on 20 pounds. You know what I mean? When I was a kid, man, I could sit back and just go. Run outside, go back, eat some more. Now I'm like, well, I'll take the dressing, but I'm not going to take the mac and cheese. And you know what I mean? It's a little bit different. People don't tell you that after you pass them 40s, man. that metabolism go down. You like, you just looking at the food. I'm just smelling. I'm already gaining weight. That's a dressing. Ooh, I feel 5 pounds. damn mac and cheese, that's Tim Mo. You know what I mean? So you just walk around smelling food. Folks think you're crazy. It's as close as I'm going to get. You know what I mean? Being real. So it's something else as you get older, how things change from the way you used to see them when you were a lot younger. So, yeah, but no, but as far as Thanksgiving go, I don't even know what I'm going to be doing for Thanksgiving. You know what? I didn't even make any plans like that. You know what I mean? With family or anything, I didn't make any plans. I have we have a sister-in-law. I sometimes hope she cook because it makes things easier for me because I don't have to cook. Let me bring a couple of dishes and slide on in where I can fit in, you know, get in where you fit in type thing. So we'll see how that works out. And we had the Democratic debates on the same day that I went to the Southern Poverty Law Center thing, but I recorded it. But we had the debates, and that part there was something for me because I was watching Kamala Harris, and I was enjoying her. I always enjoy her, but when she went at Tulsi Gabbard, I was like, go, girl. Go. Because one thing about Gabbard that's bothering me is that she's talking in the debates. She's talking and she's literally saying that she kind of, to me, I'm understanding that she's not happy with the Democratic Party in the way that it was ran in the past and that she's going to fix that problem. So my thing about it was, are you a Democrat or are you an independent? Do you get what I mean? Because it's okay to look at something and say, oh, I would do this differently. I would do that. You know how you go into a job, you're going to take a job. You can't stand back. If you they take you for the visit, you see things going on. You can't say, you know what? In your mind, you know, I can see working that and making that work better. But in the interview, you don't tell them, I'm going to take this down. I'm going to restructure this. I'm going to do this. You know what I mean? Because especially if you're being interviewed by the owner, he may think everything he's doing is okay. So when you're doing this, I'm a little worried about her with that one. You know what I mean? I knew Hillary Clinton did not like her. Speaking of Hillary Clinton, I wonder who, at the end of this, who is going to get her nominee, her support. Of all those people on that stage, I'm curious to know who's going to get that nominee. Is it going to be Joe Biden? Because, you know, he... And Joe, I'm gonna say this, we're going to break. Joe Pence, y'all know I'm for Joe Biden. I've never turned away. I've never lost my faith, my hope. But Joe, my Joe, because I love him so. You on stage, and Cory Booker get your ass every time. Seem like you ought to just be ready for Corey. You ought to have that sign of the fuck with me, Corey, today. Because he come at you. And then you let him ruffle your feathers. And then you let the age show. And I don't really want to call it age because, hell, sometimes I lose my train of thought. You know what I mean? It's just how your mind is working. Because he he said that he was endorsed by the only black. And you know... He got the black double team then. He became what? A goddamn Oreo cookie. Because that was Kamala and that was Corey and that Joe was in the middle. And they both attacked him. Pushed right up on him. And then after you messed up, he said, I said, no, you didn't. No, you didn't. You didn't say. So my thing is when I fuck up, let me just leave the fuck up there, let it ride for a minute. Let me just let this shit ride for a minute. And just hope this shit work itself out. You get what I mean? And all else fails. All that fails, look at Kamala and say, so sorry, I forgot about, you know what I mean? Something, but just let it ride. Don't try to fix it, Joe. Because see, now they looking like, damn, we get that call, Joe, we want you to push the blue button. Joe pushed the red button. You know what I mean? Because they got it, and you know Trump, they're going to try to have a field day with competency. Even though Trump can't use the word ever. Ever, 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 ever. Which is probably why these hearings are going on. Because with Joe Biden, he know he ain't got a chance in hell. Hell with none of the damn candidates, to be honest with you. But when you talk about being competent, you could tell me that Joe Biden is in his last stages of dementia. and I'm gonna put, I'm gonna fill that box in right by his name before I vote for Donald Trump. I'm gonna put that little dot there. I'm gonna be real with you, because he can do more in his last stages of dementia than Trump has done in the last coming up 4 years. Am I right? He couldn't do no worse. He couldn't do no worse. So basically, that's where I'm at with it. That's how I feel about it. And Kamala, you and Cory Booker, y'all keep up that defense. y'all was clowning. Y'all remember that the Massachusetts governor, remember Deval Patrick threw his hat in the ring and said he was going to run? How many people showed up? Remember he was doing the announcement, and what was it, four people? I'm being funny, but, you know, because it's the same day of the debate. Because I think everybody's kind of over it. Was it four people? Or two? It was two? But that was his wife and the daughter, right? I was the wife and the daughter, everybody. Not being funny, but I am. Because, you know, he supported the daughter, so it's the only right she supported him. And the wife married to him. So that was the wife and the daughter was sitting there with him, all them shrimp. You know, I'm trying to make it funny, but that's just saying it's not time, bruh. It ain't the time. Sorry about that, man. Let's go. Let's take a break. I want you to play the clip for me at my break, during my break, with Maloney's the questioning. Go ahead and play that for me, LaRon.
I know you said you have no reason to dispute what Mr. Holmes said. And I think you said you wouldn't have any reason to believe to think he didn't speak about investigations with the president. The president raised investigations with you, right?
Correct.
On the 26th.
Correct.
And we now know, of course, that was about the Bidens and Burisma in 2016, right? I mean, I know you didn't know that at the time. That's your testimony. But we now know that,
I understood it meant to mean Burisma.
Mr. Holmes says you said Bidens right after that, but I know you don't recall that, right?
That's correct.
Do you dispute it?
I do.
Okay, but you don't recall it. But we know that that's what the president meant, right? And you do confirm that he wanted to talk about investigations with you.
Well, now with the complete picture, what he said 24 hours before, yes,
I understand.
It makes sense.
And you said it's wrong to investigate political opponents. We've agreed on that today, haven't we, sir?
Yes.
And yet, of course, that's what we know the president was asking for. Let me ask you something. Who would have benefited from an investigation of the president's political opponents?
I don't want to characterize who would have and who would not have.
I know you don't want to, sir. That's my question. Would you answer it for me?
Restate your question.
Who would benefit from an investigation of the president's political opponent?
Well, presumably the person who asked for the investigation.
Who's that?
If the president asked for the investigation, it would be he.
Well, it's not a hypothetical, is it, sir? We just went around this track, didn't we? The president asked you about investigations. He was talking about the Bidens. When he asked you about the Biden investigation, who was he seeking to benefit?
He did not ask me about the Biden investigation.
When he asked you about investigations,
19 times, Mr.
Sir, Mullen. Sir, we just went through this. When he asked you about investigations, which we all agree now means the Bidens, we just did this about 30 seconds ago. It's a pretty simple question, isn't it? I guess I'm having trouble why you can't just say...
When he asked about investigations, I assumed he meant...
I know what you assumed.
Company.
But who would benefit from an investigation of the Bidens?
They're two different questions.
I'm just asking you one. Who would benefit from an investigation of the Bidens?
I assume President Trump would benefit.
There we have it, see?
That got kind of heated, didn't it?
Yeah.
You done took me all around the mulberry bush. I mean, you done took me on a trip, man. I'm exhausted. Now we got it. We finally got somewhere. Damn it, it took us a minute. Now we got here. That one was funny as heck to me. Do we have the other part of that clip, LaRon? Because I wanted to see how this finished, because this was funny as heck. He was not going to do it.
When he asked about investigations, I assumed he meant...
I know what you assumed.
Company.
But who would benefit from an investigation of the Bidens?
They're two different questions.
I'm just asking you one. Who would benefit from an investigation of the Bidens?
I assume President Trump would benefit.
There we have it. See? Didn't hurt a bit, did it? Didn't hurt a bit. But let me ask you something.
Mr. Maloney?
Hold on, sir.
Excuse me. I've been very forthright, and I really resent what you're trying to
Fair enough. You've been very forthright. This is your third try to do so, sir. Didn't work so well the first time, did it? We had a little declaration come in after, you remember that? And now we're here a third time, and we got a doozy of a statement from you this morning. There's a whole bunch of stuff you don't recall. So all due respect, sir, we appreciate your candor, but let's be really clear on what it took to get it out of you. So my question is, when the president's putting pressure on the Ukrainians, withholding a meeting, to get this investigation that you and I agree would benefit him politically, What kind of position does that put the Ukrainians in, sir?
A terrible position.
Terrible position. Why?
Why does it put them in a terrible position?
Why?
Well, obviously, they're not receiving ultimately what they thought was coming to them, and they're put in a position that jeopardizes their security.
A position that jeopardizes their security, and they're being asked to do an investigation to help their security, essentially, that would benefit the president politically. In other words, you might say they're being asked to give him a personal benefit in exchange for an official act. Is that a fair summary?
In your hypothetical, that's correct.
It's not a hypothetical, sir. This is real life. Were they asked to give him a personal benefit
by
in exchange
whom?
For an official act?
Sir, I am not going to go around in circles with you. Please be clear about what you're asking me.
My time's expired, sir. Thank you for your appearance.
How about a hot seat? He probably burning up. He probably burning up. I'm just saying. But I'll give it to him because I would have got up and just walked out and said, Trump did it. I'm sorry. But fuck it. I'm out of it. I'm gone. But if you got an opinion on whether or not they built a good case with these hearings to show... if you think that he should be impeached, let us know. Call in at 323-293-3375. I'm just saying, I want to know if you think that that for sure this is an impeachable offense.
Guilty.
But anyway, I'm just saying, guys, I have someone sitting beside me that I want you to introduce, but I'm going to let her introduce herself. Anyway, I'm going to let her introduce herself. Dallas Fowler. I'm always in Leimert Park doing things, and I have things going on. So I was really impressed to know that you are running.
Yes. Oh, got a call.
Yeah, we got a call. Okay, I'm going to take the call. I hate to make you put headsets on as soon as you sit down, and then we're going to come back right back to you.
That's
I promise.
Quite all
we're
right.
we're going to take the call. I'm just saying, this is Dionne Johnson.
Hey, Dionne, it's Denise Harris. How are you?
Hey, my sister from another mother. What's going on?
I thought I would check in with you because you're having such an amazing show today. And I dashed all through the traffic to get here to just check in and see how y'all were doing today.
We're doing okay. I was talking about Trump and this... impeachment hearing. So I'm going to see if you have a moment and tell me, do you think that Congress did its job? Do you think that they're going to impeach Trump?
Well, yeah, Congress did a phenomenal job. Adam Schiff was amazing. I was fortunate enough to be in a position that I was actually able to watch most of the hearings, and he was brilliant. They were all brilliant. It was far better than what they'd done previously. There was no grandstanding. There was no craziness. There's also no question they're going to impeach him. The real issue right now is that polling in the country is 50-50. As a matter of fact, the number of people calling for his impeachment since these hearings have gone down, and that's because I believe with the kind of social media and misinformation that people are fed, they just, everybody went back to their respective corners. They're going to be impeached, but understand that the Congress brings together the articles of impeachment. They're like the district attorney's office. The district attorney draws up the charges. But then the Senate is where the actual impeachment trial occurs. They will go for impeachment. They will go to trial in the Senate. It will be overseen by Supreme Court Head Justice John Roberts, and then it will be voted out. So he will not be removed from office, but I believe wholeheartedly that people in this country, more than anything else, want a return to order. And things have been in a state of disorder since the day after he got elected. So I think that this situation will beat him up enough that folks will just have lost the desire to have him as president. One of the things that you and I learned at the Southern Poverty Law Center event, when it came to Louisiana and I believe Wisconsin, mm-hmm. a lot of people who had voted for Trump decided not to come out and vote. So they weren't going to vote for the Democrat, but they weren't going to vote for Republican either. They just stayed home. So I'm like, that's right. Beat him up so bad that people can't bring themselves to vote for him, but they can't bring themselves to vote against him by voting for a Democrat. So they're just going to sit home. And that works for me. I'll take that.
Yeah.
That works for me.
I would take it too, without a doubt.
Yeah, I'm absolutely okay with that.
So, good deal.
I was so happy you came the other night. It really made it so great. It was wonderful to see you there, and you were networking that room. I was so proud of you. I was like, look at that girl go. So congratulations to you for coming out and networking and connecting. It meant a lot to me.
No, thank you for having me. I really enjoyed it. I learned a lot. I took a lot with me in my mind that I am still going to spew out and keep using. So thanks, and thanks for calling in. Try to have a great night. If I don't see you, have a very happy Thanksgiving, okay?
Same to you, my dear. Talk to you later.
Talk to you later.
Bye-bye.
Okay, she's absolutely right. Now, if you're not a Trump supporter, get your ass out and vote. 1 million blacks, African Americans, did not vote. We can't afford to do that. We got to show up like we did when Obama first ran for office. Our lives do depend on it, without a doubt. A change has to happen. Get your ass out and vote. Get up, my people, and get out and vote. Yeah, damn it, you're right. Buying the damn sandwiches. Are you exactly right? That's what I'm trying to say. I have Dallas Fowler here, and then I'm learning right now that she is a candidate for District 10. Lamar Park.
In Los Angeles.
Right,
yes,
in
Lamar Park Village.
Homegirl, yes. Okay, see? Do you get what? This is what Obama, this is the President Obama and Michelle Obama was talking about. When Obama left office, remember he was saying, anybody can do this. We need to get out and what did he say? Run for something.
Yes. And here we are.
So why don't you do me a favor, take a few minutes and tell us about yourself. Tell your Lamar Park family a little bit about yourself and let them know. I think you have something coming up pretty soon, and I'm not going to be here.
Yeah, our campaign office, our grand opening kickoff and Small Business Saturday is going to be next Saturday, November 30th. We will kick off our office opening, which is in the loft area at Hot and Cool in Lamert Park. We'll be there from 10 to 12. From 2 to 6, we'll be over in West Adams celebrating the Small Business Saturday, doing walks and talking and shopping and talking with all of the vendors and the businesses in the West Adams area right near the Cork, all the way down to Alta.
Okay.
So you're talking just west of Crenshaw on Adams, and you're talking just east of La Cienega on Adams. Okay, and so that's going to be a fun night. And then we have our fundraiser that night, too, in West Adams, where we're doing a matching funds, just wind down from the Small Business Saturday. We'll have been out there all day. And we're asking for $10 from 10th District residents to help us get matching funds with the city.
Yeah, I'm familiar with it. The match what you raise.
Yeah, absolutely.
So, you guys, $10. Come on. That's
Well, we're just a little bit about me. I grew up running around Lamar Park. My grandmother had a beauty shop there for over 30 years called A Touch of Class. And it's still around. It's moved down near, it was on Crenshaw and Vernon, but now it's near Vernon and Western. Okay. So still kind of just at the edge of the 10th Council District. I live in my family's home that's been there since the late 40s, 50s. And I've been there since about 2013. Before that, I lived in Leimert Park with my dad. And then prior to that, Westchester. But I grew up a third generation Angeleno. Dad went to Dorsey and L.A. High. I went to Westchester High. I went to Pilgrim, which is just on the northern part of the district near Koreatown. And it's just been a wonderful experience. But I went away to school. I went to HBCU. I went to Florida A&M. So it was I know a little bit of the South, which you were talking about, living in Tallahassee, Florida. And having the HBCU experience, which was amazing. I wouldn't trade it for the world. And coming back here and serving my community. And I've served the city of LA as a commissioner on the status of women working on human trafficking issues. We had partnered with Homeland Security to do that work and take people off the street, help them get into safe houses and away from their abusers, which is most of the time you're in that type of a captive situation. Mm-hmm. And then I also held the city's first hackathon and technology conference for women and girls as a women's commissioner. And then we moved over to LAPD permit under the Board of Police Commissioners, where we issued and revoked business permits for cafe, adult entertainment, massage parlors. We actually closed a couple massage parlors due to trafficking. So that was another area. And it was just really one of the most rewarding experiences to be able to serve. It's a lot of work. It wasn't paid. LAPD permit board, you're getting probably about 500 pages of casework every week or every other week, and that you have to go through. And but it was really great to be able to serve in that capacity. And so I'm running now because I want to continue serving now at the council level. Right. And my background was in construction and financial services. I worked for one of the largest general contractors in the world and did a lot of community affairs, labor compliance, and business development for those entities, and worked for one of the top five banks and helped to implement their national supplier diversity program. And then I've had my own small business for over 10 years now, working with small to mid-sized companies, helping them learn to do business with larger firms, and working in politics. I've been an activist my whole life. Been actively working on campaigns over 20 years. And the last campaign that I worked on, I ran the Southern California operation for our new Lieutenant Governor, Eleni Kounalakis, and was an honor to be able to help to elect California's first woman Lieutenant Governor. I think she's doing a great job, and I'm happy to have her support for this race as well.
Go, girl.
Thank you.
45, this is the count of resume you need when you gonna run for office, okay? For future reference. But you see, she don't have the complexion for the protection. So she put the work, she's putting the work in. So when we stand up here, tell the truth. When we're here, we qualified.
We qualified.
Overly.
We have to be twice as qualified often to get the job. We know what that experience is, and we're working and doing the work to change that.
I'm just saying. And yeah. The main thing that the sister's saying is she's bringing it back to her community. And she's making a difference. And it's not a I thing. She is doing something to serve, which is really the most important thing. When you have someone that is up, that's sitting here talking, and I'm listening, I'm just letting it, as it flows out, more and more, I'm just looking at the little wings growing up kind of behind her. And you're saying, okay, thank God she's a server. She's serving. You know what I mean? And that's what I'm trying to say, because that's what we're about. And that's what Martin used to say. Try to serve somebody. If it's just one somebody, try to serve. And you heard her say what they did with working with sex trafficking. Did y'all catch Trump and them? I think they had some.
We didn't catch Trump.
You know, that's what I thought happened when they, you know, I'm just throwing it out there. If you know anybody, you know, put him on the list.
That was interesting.
But I'm just, you know, not, we play because you got to play because when you're talking about the leader, you can't, you got to play about it, even though I'm very serious.
But well, there have been several allegations in terms of women being assaulted by our president, which is another thing. As you talked about the impeachment, the things that they are impeaching him for are mild compared to the crimes that he has really probably committed or that we can see have been committed. So
that's the thing. I know
the audacity of white man's manifest destiny is astounding. And we live through it every day.
I was just wondering, because, you know, when you went there, you know, that little, my little brain, but I didn't want to get started with that.
You're right.
Did you happen to catch any of the hearings? I know you're busy. You're really busy.
Yeah, it's been really tough. This is something that I would normally be living and breathing, but even at night, you know, when you're working on both ends of the stick, this is a grassroots campaign, so I don't get to watch as much. But I was really glad to see the clips that you had here today. I did get to see some of that. And some of the hearings from the first day. But, you know, we have one thing. We are adequately represented in the House. And we have a lot of talent.
A lot of
talent. And as I'm running, our 10th district, I call it the talented 10th council district because we have a lot of talent in our district, where no matter what you're doing. But as we can rest well and know that, we have Karen Bass, who was there. Mm-hmm. We have Maxine Waters, who was there. And we have Kamala Harris in the Senate. And we have all of these folks, including our speaker, Nancy Pelosi, who
is a lot of strong
not to
women.
Be...
forced to be read with.
Forced to be read with and not to be Waters. Tested.
That's a force to be reclaiming my time.
That's
She's a
right.
force to be read with. And she told him, you know where I stay. When you come for me, I'm going to come for you.
So I'm just confident that the leadership that we have there in D.C. and in the House of Representatives is going to bring us the outcome that we are
the
seeking,
that we're hoping.
Which is justice.
Just justice. And justice will be served. It may not be when we want it to, but I always say it'll be on time because there's a curtain call for everybody.
Absolutely.
Listen to you talking, the strength that you have. I was thinking about Fiona Hill. Because, you know, she testified. Lauren, do you have that tape? When she testified, that was their worst nightmare. And what was so funny to me about it was Sondland tried to make her out to be somebody weak and needy and just, you know, just not a strong woman. So he tried to play it off like what she was saying was just a woman that was crying out, you know, of anger and not, she said it because she said, when we speak out and we speak strong, we're angry women. So it was that. But let's hear her testimony. It was amazing for me.
October 14th, that I said that very unfortunately I had a bit of a blow up with Ambassador Sondland, and I had a couple of testy encounters with him. One of those was in June 18, when I actually said to him, who put you in charge of Ukraine? And, you know, I'll admit I was a bit rude. And that's when he told me the president, which shut me up. And this other meeting, it was about 15, 20 minutes, exactly as he depicted it was. I was actually, to be honest, angry with him. And, I hate to say it, but often when women show anger, it's not fully appreciated. It's often, you know, pushed onto emotional issues, perhaps, or deflected onto other people. And what I was angry about was that he wasn't coordinating with us. Now, I actually realised, having listened to his deposition, that he was absolutely right, that he wasn't coordinating with us because we weren't doing the same thing that he was doing. So I was upset with him that he wasn't fully telling us about all of the meetings that he was having. And he said to me, but I'm briefing the president. I'm briefing Chief of Staff Mulvaney. I'm briefing Secretary Pompeo, and I've talked to Ambassador Bolton. Who else do I have to deal with? And the point is, we have a robust interagency process that deals with Ukraine. It includes Mr. Holmes. It includes Ambassador Taylor as the chargé in Ukraine. It includes a whole load of other people. But it struck me yesterday when you put up on the screen Ambassador Sondland's emails and who was on these emails, and he said, these are the people who need to know that he was absolutely right. because he was being involved in a domestic political errand. And we were being involved in national security foreign policy, and those two things had just diverged. So he was correct, and I had not put my finger on that at the moment, but I was irritated with him and angry with him that he wasn't fully coordinating. And I did say to him, Ambassador Sondland, Gordon, I think this is all going to blow up, and here we are.
She was right. And if you want to, I want you guys to go to YouTube and look up her talking, because there's a part when in this interview, because it's long, and they asked her about her being in grade school and the young boy set her hair on fire and doing a test. She put it out with her bare hands and continued on with the test. But Sondland wants you to believe this is a woman that's fearful and weak. So we'll leave it at that. Now, the winner of the book, and that is going to be receiving that book, is Miss Laura Clark. So congratulations, and thanks for reaching out. Thanks for showing support, love and support. I'm just getting started, so thank you so much for that. Now, we have this new thing that we've done. I'm going to rush through this that I'm going to do every month. And since we are in Leimert Park and they have the village there, we call it the Village Idiot of the Month Award. And I have five nominees. I had four, but five, the fifth one had to go on there. We have Gordon Sondland, right? Three amigos, right? We know who he is. They're around the bush, okay? We got the New York City, ex-New York City mayor, Trump's personal lawyer, Rudy Giuliani. You just to look at him would say idiot anyway. Okay. Then we got Trump advisor Roger Stone, okay, who was found guilty on charges. We already know, lying to Congress. Remember, Roger came out and said he didn't have anything to worry about when they first indicted him. I don't have anything to worry about. Guilty, all seven counts. You know what I mean? But he didn't have anything to worry about. So he has to be on that list. Mitch McConnell, I put your ass on the list this morning when I found out. You said, go ahead and do whatever you got to do. And I put your ass on that list. Sorry, because you were stupid. Said, if they do this, then send them to do what they have to do. Mulvaney, you on it because you're still not testifying. And the reason you guys are on the list is because you're doing something foolish. But the biggest idiot is the one that he just showed, the one that's going to jail. And there he is right there, because he's the one that another one bites the dust. He is going to jail. I don't care what you say, Roger Stone, you are the village idiot. Okay? Now I'm going to wrap up, and we're going to wrap up instead of LaRon playing my music. We're going to end with the wonderful Representative Adam Schiff and his closing remarks about the hearings and what he had to say, the ending of it, which was so profound. It's been a wonderful night. Dallas Fowler, thank you for coming on. Give me a moment of your time. I'm going to have her back on. That's a promise. We're going to talk more about it. If I don't see you guys, which I will not because I won't be here next Friday, have a very happy Thanksgiving. And I love you guys. All right? I'm just saying, enjoy the holidays. Enjoy the family. It's all about love. Again, Dallas.
Thank you.
Thank you. You guys, if you're in Leimert Park, be looking for her. She's going to be there the day after Saturday.
Absolutely.
Weekend of Thanksgiving.
Next Saturday.
So
and we'll
come
be
out.
There. We'll be there this Saturday, too.
Oh, they're going to be there this Saturday, yes. Too. So be there. Show your support. Show your love. Schiff, take me home, man.
Country stands for. I happen to think that's why they put that remedy in the Constitution. And I think we need to consult our conscience and our constituents and decide whether that remedy is appropriate here, whether that remedy is necessary here. And as you know, notwithstanding what my colleague said, I resisted going down this path for a long time, but I will tell you why I could resist no more. And it came down to this. It came down to timing. It came down to the fact that the day after Bob Mueller testified, that Donald Trump invited Russian interference, hey, Russia, if you're listening, come get Hillary's emails, and later that day, they tried to hack her server. The day after he testified that not only did Trump invite that interference, but that he welcomed the help in the campaign, they made full use of it, they lied about it, they obstructed the investigation into it, and all this is in his testimony and his report. The day after that, Donald Trump is back on the phone asking another nation to involve itself in another U.S. election. That says to me, this president believes he is above the law, beyond accountability. And in my view, there is nothing more dangerous than an unethical president who believes they are above the law. And I would just say to people watching here at home and around the world, in the words of my great colleague, we are better than that. Adjourned.